So, 16th of March, 1985, Beirut, 8:15 in the morning. Two journalists in tennis whites pull up outside their apartment. Everything seems quiet. One of them is Terry Anderson, whose suggestion it was at a party the previous evening that, hell, they ought to get fit. Why don't we play tennis? They see a car with three rather threatening-looking men in it. This is not an unusual occurrence in Beirut in 1985. One of the men is the AP photographer Don Mell. He gets out of the car and sees that one of the men has a Beretta pistol coming towards him, and he thinks, they're here for me, they're here to kidnap me. He tells Terry Anderson, Sulome's father, that this is the case, that he's the one they're after. Terry is trying to start the car as quickly as possible, but can't get it into gear. And things start sort of unfolding with that nightmarish quality that they have when everybody knows that something terrible is about to happen. The man puts the Beretta to the head of Don Mell, the photographer, and sort of waves him off. Meanwhile, another man, a very large, muscular fellow, comes and literally reaches through the car window and gets Terry and pulls him out. And Sulome's father is a pretty big guy himself. All of this takes place without a word being spoken by the three men. There is a taxi rank, a Beiruti taxi rank, right there, and everybody is watching. They know what's happening. An American is being kidnapped, but nobody does anything. Of course, they're too scared. The three men bundle Terry into the back of the car. He has to lie on the floor, and nobody's spoken a word up until this point when one of the men says to him, "Don't worry, it's political." That was the beginning of almost 7 years in captivity for Terry Anderson. At times he was shackled, at times he was blindfolded, sometimes he was beaten and tortured, sometimes he was alone, sometimes there was company. This was the middle of what became known as the Lebanese Hostage Crisis. They passed the hours sometimes playing chess with little tinfoil figures they made from food wrappers that had been discarded until their captors discovered this and would destroy the chess pieces. One of the best times recalled by another captive, John McCarthy, a British journalist, was when the captors gave them a television and a video player and one video, which was Rambo, which they watched until the tape ran out, until the tape wore out 140 times. They knew Rambo by heart. I think if you're going to have one movie in your captivity, Rambo is not the movie I would choose. When this event happened, Sulome hadn't even been born. Her mother was 6 months pregnant. And so Sulome was literally born into this crisis. One of her editors said when she was proposing this book, "You know, how dare you write a memoir? You're only 28 years old." But her life literally started in a remarkable fashion. So I guess the first question I'd ask you is, what are the first memories you have of your unusual and terrible situation, the fact that your father was gone, was a hostage, and might be killed at any moment?
Well, the first memory I personally have I can't say that I even remember not knowing it. I've always known what happened to my father, that he was being held against his will. I always heard, you know, bad men had him, and he would be coming home soon. That's what my mother always told me. Recently, I found a newspaper clipping from when I was two. So this is before I even have memory of this incident. But apparently, a news crew had asked if I had a message for my father. And at 2 years old, I said, "Daddy, please come home. Our hearts are breaking." So this was just something that I always was aware of. I never didn't understand that these things could happen to someone, that somebody could be taken from their life and held like this.
And even though you're just, you know, 3, 4, 5 years old, you are quite perceptive. I mean, sometimes you hear your mother sobbing behind a door and you know what this is about.
Yeah. It was hard, I think, for my mom, really hard, because she, you know, obviously she wanted to put on a good face for me. She wanted to be strong for me. You know, she would send presents to my house and sign them for my father. There was always the sense that he was coming home soon. That was always, and I would get impatient. I would ask, you know, when is soon? When is he coming home? And, you know, my mom obviously didn't have an answer to that. So, you know, honestly, I think my mom is the unsung hero of the story. She was a rock.
I think anybody who's as old as me just about remembers these incredibly dramatic TV pictures of the hostages getting out. Your dad was released to the embassy in Damascus. And you'd had this fantasy all these years growing up of this wonderful dad, this superhero, and then suddenly he's there. And this is the happy ending, right?
I mean, to the world, it certainly was. You know, this was an event that people had been incredibly invested in. It was front page news for almost 7 years. Recently, I had a woman, probably a couple of years ago when I was writing this book, she sent me a message on Facebook and she said, my mother just died. We didn't know these people. They were from my father's birth town, Lorain, Ohio, but we didn't personally know them. And she said, my mother just died, and she kept a scrapbook for the entire 7 years that your father was imprisoned, and I'd like to send it to you. So she sent me the scrapbook, which was absolutely moving. I mean, you know, it was the fact that somebody could devote that kind of time and energy and care to what happened to my family is really humbling. So when my father was released, it was the culmination, the end of all of that waiting and hoping and care, and people obviously wanted it to be over then. They wanted it to be happy. They wanted us to be happy. And I think that's, you know, in many ways quite lovely, but that's rarely how things work.
I've interviewed a lot of people who've been soldiers in war or been kidnapped themselves, like your father, and there's such a sort of emotional anticipation of this golden future that clearly it has to go wrong when the golden future actually arrives. So the AP, the Associated Press, your father's employer, sent you all off to a beach in the Caribbean, and you basically had this little girl full of longing and this incredibly traumatized man who didn't know how to speak to her. How did the problems manifest themselves? I mean, it was the start of a long period of agony of years for you, wasn't it?
Yeah, I have this picture actually that I found during the course of my reporting on this book, and it's of me and my father, and I'm holding out a teddy bear to him. This was in the days after I met him, actually, I think in Wiesbaden, when we were at the hostage recovery facility, and I'm holding out this teddy bear to him, and he's looking at me, and it's so obvious that we're being so careful with each other. It's kind of heartbreaking, and it started just, as far as I can remember, this feeling that it didn't feel real. The way he was talking to me, the love that he was trying to show me, it didn't feel real. Now, looking back, I know that, of course, it was real. It was just that he had no way of really expressing it. He had no capacity to express it. He had been traumatized to the extent that he built a wall between himself and his emotions. That was his way of coping. It didn't manifest like most PTSD cases do. There, you know, nightmares and flashbacks and all that. I don't think that ever happened. In fact, the therapists who were supposed to be treating him were convinced that they all said, you know, he seems so well. He seems like he's, you know, survived this event with you know, his sanity intact. And he was, of course, convinced that he was fine. So I think the problem was that he never allowed himself to feel any of the things that are completely normal for someone with a soul to feel in those circumstances. And you know, as a child, it felt to me like everything he was doing was contrived, or it was like I sensed that his ability to connect with me was stunted. I was a really sensitive child. Looking back, I mean, it was nobody's fault, you know? It was just, we just didn't understand.
There was shouting, there were harsh words, and he would tell you in fights that the only person who could really make him enraged was you, which you took as a kind of compliment, which naturally made you tend to enrage him all the more to get the attention. So this kind of, you had this long period of growing estrangement when you kind of went off the rails as a young woman.
Yeah, the thing about my dad is he would alternate between, you know, this sort of like awkward love, affection, that kind of thing, and then also just dismissive or sort of numb. I felt very much like I wasn't like an inconvenience to him. Like I was in the way. I know that he and my mother were having trouble in their relationship, and I was the focal point of many of their fights. And then, you know, as time went by and I became older, I hit puberty and all that, you know, all that happened, and it started to manifest in my mind as if it was my fault. I think on a deep, deep subconscious level, I felt like my father didn't love me, and it was my fault. And my mother was sad because of me. And it just became this this thought that sort of grew and grew in my mind and in my soul that there was something wrong with me. And that, of course, led to, you know, mental illness and much drug abuse and just a very long period of unhappiness.
When, having read the book, which is this incredibly wrenching, painful story, but it's also the story of you kind of finding your way back to your father and finding a way that you can have a relationship with him. But you didn't know that when you started writing it. So what made you start this investigation of his kidnapping and what exactly happened?
So no, I had no idea that the process of the book would bring me so close to my father. In fact, I went back and looked at an early draft of the book recently, and it was much angrier. there was a lot more like angst and rage and all that. And then, you know, as the process, but the reason I actually embarked on this journey was, at that point, I had already moved to Lebanon, and I had started reporting there, and I had started spending time around Hezbollah members just in the course of my job. And, you know, they would say things to me, interestingly enough, once they found out who my father was, some of them would say things to me like, oh, we know your father was kept in that building, or we know where one of your father's kidnappers lives. He lives like in that building right there. And, you know, as I went through this, when I started reporting in Lebanon, I didn't really want to write about my father. I just, first of all, I didn't want it to be an in for me in the industry. And, you know, it's a source of pride to me that none of my editors knew who my father was when they started publishing me. But, you know, it was unavoidable because my family's story is so intertwined with the Civil War, and the Civil War is so visible in Lebanon still. I mean, it's everywhere. You can't escape it. And that history kept sort of emerging for me. And it happened so often that it just, you know, it coincided also with a time in my personal life where I started to feel like I could go there. I could explore not only what happened to my family, but also the actual event itself as a reporter. So I wrote a piece for The Atlantic in 2013 about kidnapping in Lebanon, which was the first piece I ever mentioned my family history in. And that piece, you know, was successful, and people started asking me, you know, you should write a book. We want to know more. So yeah, it was just a bunch of things just converging at once.
So this is a detective story in many ways, and the history of kidnapping in Lebanon is incredibly convoluted, and I think you've added an even more opaque layer of conspiracy theory to the many conspiracy theories out there. Yet reading your book, it seems a credible story, which is essentially that an Iranian general directed the kidnapping, and this general the whole time was an Israeli mole. Could you explain that?
So that was something that happened, and I think I describe it in the book pretty much exactly as it happened, which was it happened well into my reporting that I came upon this sort of theory. And it was, my first reaction was like, okay, you know, this is something that pops up again and again in the Arab world, this idea that Israel is, you know, responsible for everything. And, you know, and there is, while there is some truth to it in that, you know, the Mossad is the most, I would say, the most sophisticated spy agency in the world, if not, you know, on par with the CIA. And, you know, spy agencies don't spend their time knitting sweaters. They work. This is what they do. Their job is to further, you know, the agenda of their country, however that may be. And at the time, the Lebanon was so, it was, you know, it was absolute chaos. There was many different actors from many, many different countries, all, you know, intelligence services. It was just, you know, it was a mishmash of things. And it, as I started, you know, looking into this for many reasons, which you'll have to read the book to understand, I started thinking that, you know, there might be something there. And, you know, I followed up on this over the course of, you know, I think about a year and a half to 2 years was when I started exploring this idea. And it just, and I make this clear in the book, I can't say that any of these theories 100% true, because, you know, frankly, there's, unless I got a silver bullet document that was like, this is what happened, which it's been 30 years, and, you know, there's really no way of having something like that happen. But I do have the journey itself and what people tell me, and, you know, my thoughts about it. And then, you know, people who say the opposite, say that's crazy, that could never have happened. And I included that as well. So I guess try to be brief with this, but as a theory, I think it stands along with many others as something that deserves attention.
You'll have to buy the book to get the whole theory. It's really good theory.
It's complex.
Do you have a copy of the book there?
I don't think so.
If somebody could bring this one for the back, I'll get you to read a passage in a second. But
yeah.
Excellent. Thank you. One tiny piece of evidence for this theory is that you started having weird, persistent, and rather extreme computer problems when you got to the Mossad part of the manuscript.
That was crazy. People in my life, there's some people here who were present for that episode of my life, which was intense and probably the worst 3 months that I can think of. It was, you know, it's one of those...
Worse than all the coke and everything. I mean.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, imagine not being able to log on to the internet on any of your devices at all. It started slowly. It started with, you know, my internet would slow and then it would stop. And then all these warnings started popping up on my screen. You know, there's a computer on your IP address, another computer's using your network, and then my internet would stop. I had two computers actually shut down and not power on again. My phone stopped accessing the internet. It became insane. And, you know, at this point I was completely paranoid. I was like, you know, I thought I was going crazy. And I would go to digital security experts and be like, what is happening to me? You know, I have screenshots, I have all this evidence, please tell me what's going on. And they'd be like, well, you know, no spy agency would be so obvious about their surveillance of you. And I'm like, no, that's fine. I don't think that they're trying to surveil me. I mean, to be fair, we're in 2017 now. Any, you know, the CIA, the NSA, we all know the access that these people have to our lives electronically. That's not what they're trying to do, whoever it was, and I don't want to speculate on who it was because, frankly, I can't know that, obviously, but it was an attempt to intimidate me and stall me, which worked because for 3 months I didn't work on the book at all. I couldn't. By the end of it, I was working on an air-gapped computer with a stack of transcripts this high, paper transcripts. You know, it was one of those episodes in my life that I'm very relieved it's over, because the minute I handed in the first draft of my book, not a peep, not a single problem with my computer since. I can't explain it. I'm not going to make speculations on who's behind it or whatever. All I know is that this happened. Yeah.
I mean, I'll get you to read the passage we discussed in a second, but I mean, there's other evidence for this. Asghari, the Iranian brigadier general, actually ended up disappearing while in Turkey, popping up in the United States, and then ending up living in Israel. So there's a lot of evidence, and you set it out very deftly in the book. As you kind of progress through the investigation, you also stumble across one of the men who held your father, perhaps not surprising since you were gently probing different parts of Hezbollah, but still quite an unexpected thing. And then you find yourself sitting face to face with the man who held your father for 7 years, who crippled him emotionally, who gave you years of misery. What did you say to him? What happened? And I, if you want to read the passage.
I'll read the passage. Well, let me just briefly intro this with the explanation of how I met this man. I had interviewed him for... I was interviewing him for a story completely unrelated to the book. It was a story about there was a flare-up on the Israeli border in January 2015. I don't know if anybody remembers this, but you know, there was exchange of fire, and I went down to report on this, and at some point, I interviewed this man who was a Hezbollah official about the story, and then at the end of the interview, my fixer happened to just mention, you know, oh, you'll never guess who her father is, because at this point we have been, we'd been pretty open about this with most of the people we interviewed, mostly because their reactions to that information were so interesting and so rich, you know, reporting-wise, it was interesting to see how they reacted to that, you know, to my identity and my father's identity. So he was pretty free with this information, and as soon as he said that, this man just went completely white. Like, the blood just drained from his face, and he just stopped and stared at me, and he looked at my fixer and said, why didn't you warn me? And my fixer said, why would I warn you? Because they have a complicated relationship. And he looked at me, he said, I feel ashamed, in Arabic, which I speak. And I said, why would you feel ashamed? And he said, I feel like you must hate us. And I said to him, you know, at this point I had been reporting the book for some time, and I said, I'm not angry. I don't hate anyone. I just want to know what happened. And he said, I have someone I want you to meet. He was involved, because at this point we had built a rapport. Like, we weren't exactly like best friends, but we got along as well as a journalist and a source can get along. And he said, I have someone I want you to meet. He was involved, and I'll bring him the next time you come. So I said, yes, please, I really want to meet this man. Some time went by, and I went back to visit him. And I said, you know, when am I going to meet this man? This went on a couple of times. He kept saying, next time, next time. And then at the end of one of the interviews, because I interviewed him for another piece after that, and then I kept visiting him to get him to introduce me to this man. And then at the end of one of those visits, I went outside to kind of let my fixer do his thing, trying to convince him to introduce me to this man. And at the end, I remember hearing them speaking in Arabic, and I was outside waiting, and my fixer comes out looking like somebody punched him in the stomach. And I looked at him and said, what's going on? He said, get in the car. So we wave goodbye, and we get in the car, and he just looks at me, and he said, it was him. It was him. He was the man. He's the man he's been describing. So that moment, I had spent hours with this man at this point. I had, you know, drank his coffee, eaten his food, and played with his kids, and, you know, made friends with his wife. It was absolutely earth-shattering to me. If I could choose one moment in my life that absolutely, you know, was the most surreal, it would have to be that moment. I think I sat there for about 10 minutes and didn't say a word. So this part that I'm about to read is the first conversation we have following that, where he actually is open with me about his role. So let's see, I gotta find it.
And we'll take a few questions after Sulome has read the passage.
Yeah. Here we go. All right. Chapter 11, The Integration. No human being, when you understand his desires, is worthless. No one's life is nothing. Even the most evil of men and women, if you understand their hearts, had some generous act that redeems them, at least a little, from their sins. Orson Scott Card. The afternoon of May 28th, 2015 is dragging its feet. It's the very last day of my third trip to Lebanon in 5 months. I have a flight to catch at 8 the next morning. All my efforts to persuade the Mas'ul to finally set a date for this interview have proven fruitless. Desperate, I call my fixer and ask him what we should do. Fuck it, he says colorfully. By now, the poor man has spent an extraordinary amount of time trying to get the Mas'ul to sit down with me. In many ways, it's become his quest as well as mine, although he too has asked me not to include any identifying information about him because he wants to avoid the headache Hezbollah would give him from bringing me around these people. Let's just go. He can't ignore us if we're outside his house. So we jump in the car, drive to Jnoub, and call the Mas'ul when we're 5 minutes away. Arab hospitality being the revered institution it still is in those parts, he can't really say no. When we arrive, he welcomes us in, and we sit down in his living room as he serves us coffee and presses a cigarette on me. I light it and feel the smoke curl around my face. The Mas'ul and I look at each other. The moment is like a foundation stone finally shifting into place. It feels as inevitable as a mountain avalanche in winter. Before we got there, my fixer told me to act as though I didn't know the man the Mas'ul had spoken about was actually him, but the pretense is immediately dropped by us both. The Mas'ul must understand that I know who he is by the set of my shoulders when I walk into his house, the confusion in my eyes. He spreads his hands almost helplessly. You should be interviewing the American soldiers on the New Jersey who killed our people after they lied and said they were neutral, then took the Israeli side, he tells me as I jot down his words in my notebook. He's referring to an incident in which the US battleship fired upon Druze and Shia militias in the hills overlooking Beirut. For some reason, supposedly having to do with bad gunpowder, the ship's fire was disastrously inaccurate, some shells missing their targets by 10,000 yards. When the dust settled, hundreds of civilians in the Shia suburbs of Beirut lay dead. Many cite the USS New Jersey incident as a pivotal moment in the Lebanese Civil War, after which the neutrality of the US force in Lebanon came under serious question, and Lebanese Muslims began to believe the United States had chosen the side of the Christians and their Israeli sponsors. Do you know why we kidnapped your father? The Mas'ul asks me. It was nothing personal. Our fight was not with Terry Anderson or the other hostages. Our fight was with the people who had slaughtered our families. But you ruined my family, I tell him. The Mas'ul holds my pain up to the light and examines it. I can tell it hurts him to look at it. He sighs. When we took your father, we weren't thinking about you, he replies. You're sitting here in front of me now. You're a decent, good, respectable girl. I like you very much. And I liked your father. He is a good man, the best out of all those we took. But it could have been anyone. If someone else had caught our eye, we would have taken him. I look at you now and I feel for you. I think about your father and I feel for him too. But at the time, we didn't see your father as Terry Anderson, the person. To us, he was America.
Okay, would anybody like to ask a question?
Got a microphone here if you don't mind raising your hands.
Don't all get up at once.
Hi. So I guess my question is, you know, it seems like it was a really strained and struggling relationship to sort of get to know and connect with your dad, and that the process of writing the book was pretty cathartic. And I guess the question is, like, how are you guys now? Like, how's it going?
well, you know, as I started reporting this book and really got an idea of, you know, the severity of what happened to my father, obviously. And then, you know, I would talk to people like Terry Waite, who was one of my father's fellow hostages. And he told me this story about, you know, my dad holding his hand while he had bronchitis and they were held together. And he said to me, your father is an extraordinarily good man. And at this point, you know, I was still very angry at my dad for, you know, for the sort of difficulty of our relationship and the difficulty he had in building a connection with me. But it was kind of a revelation to think, you know, maybe my father is a really good man. He just wasn't a particularly effective father. And then, you know, I realized, well, he hasn't really had much of an opportunity to be a good father. Forget about what happened to him before that. You know, his childhood was very difficult. I don't think he had a particularly positive model for parenting. So I guess understanding the context of what happened, I started to forgive him and forgive myself, which was actually, I think, the real problem is that I was more angry at myself. Again, because of that thought that it was my fault, which I think many children have in situations like that. And then my father and I started to build a real relationship around my reporting. My dad was, you know, I think one of the best reporters of his time. He rose to the top of his field. And he loved what he did very much, just as I love what I do very much. So we started bonding over that a lot. I would ask him things about the book. I would ask him obviously his opinion and his thoughts on things. And we just started building a relationship. And then I think also, as he read the memoir part of my book and saw the kind of emotional damage that I experienced, I think it really woke him up to the kind of emotional damage that he had experienced in a way that he was unable to previously access. So over the course of the 3 years that I spent writing this book, I saw my dad just like have all these feelings that I've never seen him have before. He started, you know, crying all the time, which literally the man never cried. I mean, throughout my entire childhood, I don't remember a single time of him crying. And now he has, you know, cries all the time. And you know, it just, it really was, unexpected and incredibly, positive outcome of this book was that my father and I now have a relationship that I consider to be quite close.
Just before we go to the next question, I want to ask, it's very hard to write about people you know, because if you're honest and a good journalist, you end up saying things which, you know, good friends or good daughters ought not to say. You're pretty tough on your mother as well in the book. How does she feel about it? And how does your dad feel about some of the harsh things you had to say in the book?
Well, my mom's right there, but from what I understand, my mom has been, you know, really wonderful in that she said, she's always said to me, and so has my father actually, that this is your story, this is your truth. You can't actually think about our feelings when you write this. You know, obviously, I'm sure for my mother, it was difficult to read some of the things because we had a fraught relationship for a long time too, which I also think in many ways was situational. But you know, we got through it. And in the book, I mean, as far as I know, I think I tried to approach both my parents from a place of empathy, at least towards the end of my reporting. I really have a lot of empathy for both of them. And I hope that that came across in the book as well. I imagine that it must've been quite difficult for both of them. My father called me after he read it in his absolute, like just almost sobbing. And he said to me, this is the best piece of writing I've ever read, which was quite wonderful. Yeah. Yeah. Definitely the best review.
Yeah, I'm just wondering. Now, your father spent almost 7 years being held. I'm sure when he was released, the government debriefed him for some time to find out about the situation, the captors, and all that. Now, being done with that, was there any effort to re-socialize him back into society? If they just let him go, he's gonna be so damaged by it all. It takes a long time to learn how to connect with people and be re-socialized back into society, especially in communication with his family, especially yourself. So that's what I was wondering, if they had, the government had made any effort to ease his transition.
Yeah, I think you know, we went straight from Damascus. We went to Wiesbaden, which they have a hostage recovery center where they treat former hostages and their families. So there was a lot of debriefing and therapy and obviously medical care because he was in poor physical health. And then we were assigned, a psychologist who lived with us for quite some time, I think a month or two, or more than that, 2 months, 3 months. And I remember him very well. I actually interviewed him at the beginning of this book. I didn't include his quotes in the book, but I wanted to get a sense of his perception of our relationship. And he said, you know, he seemed fine. That was what
did
Karen...
Did you do any follow-ups after that initial period?
I mean, I don't think that my father would have been open to that. He was very dismissive of psychiatry and psychology in general, I think because, you know, he didn't want to go there. Should there have been more of an effort? I think now, if this had happened now, I think there would be more of an effort. There's much more awareness of the importance of psychiatry and psychology and PTSD. I think it would have been a more holistic approach, but it was, you know, it was not adequate at the time, no.
Considering what he had gone through, did he seek any reparations from the Lebanese government for, you know, to make them pay for the... I'll read the book. I just wanted to find out.
No, it's a great question. Well, we ended up in a lawsuit against Iran when I was 15, and we, you know, for funding, the Iranian government obviously was involved, and you know, different factions of it maybe, but they were all aware of it, and you know, and I would still consider the Iranian government quite responsible for what happened. So they had assets frozen in the United States, and through this new legislation that happened right around the time that I was 15, you know, we testified in court and all that, and we were awarded reparations, yeah.
Good, good. Okay.
Hey, can you talk, excuse me, can you talk about how sort of you started reporting in the Middle East and how your father's experience and your experience with his experience led to that and informed it when you were there?
Yeah, so looking back, at the time when I first started reporting in the Middle East, I was still like pretty deep into my difficult period. You know, I had been diagnosed with a mental illness, borderline personality disorder. I was still very much in the throes of that. And I don't think I was self-aware enough to really understand why I was doing what I was doing. I graduated from Columbia Journalism School and then immediately moved to Lebanon. Without much thought as to why I was doing it. It just seemed like it made sense. You know, my family was there and you know, I had roots there and all that. But then a little while after, I think about a year after I started freelancing there, a very well-known TV reporter, who I'm sure you know, I won't say his name. I can't. But he said to me, I had just met him and I found this very strange, but he said, Sulome, did you become a reporter to feel closer to your father? And, you know, looking back, that was definitely the first moment that I was like, oh, that's why I'm doing this. Because, you know, my dad was really good at what he did. And I think on some level, I must have really wanted to excel at the profession that he excelled at in the place that he excelled at it. Because I wanted us to have something that we could share. I wanted him to be proud of me. And I don't think that really, you know, that I really understood that until I really started reporting this book.
Time for a few more questions, if there are any.
As a journalist, we're taught, you know, that it's about reporting and the facts and never to insert yourself into the story. And you'd been reporting for years before you wrote this book. So how hard was it to sort of let go of that and include yourself in the story and sort of focus on your part of this?
That's a great question. So my attitude towards, you know, objectivity in journalism, I think it's absolutely incredibly valuable. I don't think, it's you know, a dying thing. But I think as to, you know, my personal opinions, I'm pretty open about my personal opinions on the Middle East. I think that we all have opinions, right? All reporters have opinions. We cannot talk about them and that's fine, but you know, we still have them. And in many ways they're very valuable because we have proximity to the things that we report on. We have a perspective on these issues that other people don't have. So I believe our opinions are valuable as opinions. Then again, when I report, you know, and I've written essays and things like that, and I think it's important to differentiate very clearly between an essay and an objective third-person piece of reporting. When I do objective third-person pieces of reporting, I try really hard to work against my bias or work against my opinion, and, you know, lean even a little bit more in the opposite direction to really try and get those two perspectives because I do believe they're very important. It was new for me. That Atlantic piece, like I said, was the first piece of writing I did where I actually included my story. And it felt very uncomfortable at first. And then, you know, I had a period where I was like, well, I want to write a bunch of essays because, you know, it just, I'm thinking about, you know, myself and my family a lot. And it just was, you know, what I was involved in. So I started writing essays. And I think I've come to a place now where I want to focus more on objective journalism again. I think, like I said, I think you can do both, and you can do both well.
And you did both really well in the book, which is why I was wondering, like, how hard it was to do that, because, again, it's not most reporters' natural instinct to write about themselves as the story.
Yeah, it's very, it's weird. I mean, it felt really weird to me because I've always focused, you know, until that point, I went to J school at Columbia where they're like, this is not, you know, you don't do that. It is off limits. And then, you know, I had, you know, reporters for parents. So they were of the school that you don't do that either. So yeah, it was uncomfortable for me to focus on myself at first, and then it became too comfortable. And then I got to a place where I was like, okay, you know, I had that period of my life where I felt the need to have an opinion on everything. That's great. I'm going to try to lean back in the other direction again.
Time for one more. Yeah.
Thank you. I actually have about 1,000 questions for you. I lived in Lebanon from 83 to 84. I knew your mom. We worked together, and I knew your dad. I knew a lot of the journalists, Jeremy Levin and Charlie Glass, who were also kidnapped. So, you know, interestingly, journalists were targets sometimes, of course, people in academia, the universities, and then, of course, the legitimate spies. So the hostage taking, you know, is so fascinating in and of itself. I guess the question I'll ask here, because you're in a position to answer this, is I loved Beirut and Lebanon so much. It was an amazing year. How is it for you compared to what your parents said it was like 30 years ago and before? I imagine it's a fascinating place, but it's probably changed a lot too.
Wow, that's a great question. I wrote a piece for Vice not long ago about, you know, sort of the idea of Arab nostalgia, right? This sense of, you know, Lebanon before the war, the time of Fairuz, and you know, this very strong sense of nostalgia for something that you know, is gone now, that has been destroyed by war. So I grew up with that as well. That's something I think most Lebanese children grow up with, that, you know, this very romanticized version of Lebanon before the war. And, you know, as I personally had many, many positive associations with Lebanon growing up as well. Like most Lebanese kids, I think, diaspora Lebanese, you know, their parents feel the need to make this pilgrimage every year, you know, back to the homeland and show, you know, your kid how beautiful Lebanon is and, you know, that it's the best country in the world and all Arabs want to be Lebanese secretly. Yeah. And we're actually Phoenician, not Arabs. So this was what I grew up with. And then, you know, as I became older and started reading more about it and really seeing the actual reality of the situation, which is much more complicated and dark and awful. And Lebanon, I still believe, is the most beautiful country I've ever been to in terms of just landscape, geography. It's absolutely gorgeous and varied. You know, there's the mountains and the sea and the valleys and the south, which is my favorite part, actually. And it's this juxtaposition between the beauty of the country itself and the inability of its citizens to get along or to really create a functioning government. I mean, it's difficult because you look at Lebanon also as the absolute, you know, example of what happens when proxy wars destroy a country and outside forces become involved and everybody is betting on their horse and, you know, sort of setting them against other people. And there's no way for a country to really develop well that way, obviously. But then again, there's also the inherent factionalism, sectarianism of the Lebanese. This is a mentality that is really a problem in Lebanon. There is no way for anything to get done. I mean, for God's sake, they just spent how long arguing over who's going to collect the trash? Meanwhile, the trash in Beirut piled up to the point where it was absolutely a health hazard for almost a year, I think. So it's a frustrating place. If you love Lebanon, you hate it too. There's not a chance that you can't because you see all the potential there and you know that it could be so much better than it is. It could be something really, really wonderful and it's heartbreaking that it's not.
The parties are still pretty good, right?
yeah, the parties are great, definitely.
Okay, so Sulome, as well as the book, writes for a lot of publications. You have a cover story in Newsweek this week. There'll be a story in New York Magazine on what the Middle East thinks of Donald Trump. That is a must read. And she will be signing books, and afterwards, if anybody would like to join us for a drink, you'd be very welcome. But Sulome Anderson, ladies and gentlemen.